Hello there once again, everyone. This is UXW Bill here with another antique, or vintage if you prefer, computer video. What I have for you today is kind of an interesting system. This is an Apple Macintosh Performa 6400/180. It means it's clocked at 180 megahertz. I believe this uses the PowerPC 603 microprocessor. And what this is, this system is truly an amazing find because it is a one-owner computer. The guy who owned this bought it new back in 1995 and has used it up until about 2 or 3 weeks ago when he finally decided to take a big leap forward into the year 2011 and he bought himself a brand new iMac. This thing ended up coming home with me because he had no need for it. And as you can see, there is really nothing wrong with any of this stuff. I even got the complete set of books and discs with it, which will be the next thing that I go through. And then the computer over here. It's really quite an amazing find. I have worked on this thing ever since he became aware of the fact that I do computer work. I've done all the maintenance and work on this thing, but it hasn't needed much over the years. In fact, the only thing that it's needed, it shipped from the factory with a Quantum Fireball IDE hard drive in it. I think around 1.2 gigabytes or so. I'm not sure of the capacity, but I think that's got to be close. Well, back in 2005, in June of 2005, and I don't know that I can do this. Yeah, I'm going to have to stop the camera. All right, I'm back. In June of 2005, this thing's hard drive finally started to suffer from stiction and it would not spin up, which is a common problem with those Quantum Fireball drives. Well, I'm perfectly happy to service old computers. It's one of my big selling points in the computer work that I do because practically nobody else will touch them, but I keep a library of old parts and things around and at the ready in case someone needs them. Now, it's not to say I recommend using a computer well past its use-by date, but eventually, went ahead and replaced this. I thought this was a Connor drive, but this is actually a Seagate drive that is a relabeled Connor drive, and this is the ST31621A, and you can see the Connor part number below that. That's the CFS1621A, so I would guess, yeah, this is a 1.6 gigabyte hard drive, and you can see the notes I wrote on there back in 2005. I tested this drive, and I actually used Mac OS X to copy the data from the old drive to the new, which, and Carbon Copy Cloner, I used that as well, which was perfectly happy to do the job. The only thing I had to figure out how to do was how to create an HFS, or Hierarchical File System, and I probably bungled the pronunciation on that, as opposed to an HFS Plus volume, which the system software on this thing, it's running Mac OS System 7.5, cannot read, so you have to use the older HFS system. And once I had cracked that problem, I was able to copy the data no problem, and the machine has been running happily ever since. You can see the CD-ROM drive here. This is a Panasonic drive, and you can see it's just like the one in my CD server, in that while it has the outlines for the characters, like the front panel controls and the headphone jack here and the volume control, there is no thing left over for the activity light, but they did provide an emergency eject hole, which Apple actually copied through to the front panel, so you could do that if it ate a CD and wouldn't give it back. And it also has the compact disc logo on it. But that's actually a SCSI drive too. This machine has a hybrid architecture. I don't know what I have to do to get that to go back in there properly. There's the drive back in place now. I just had to fiddle with it a little bit. There's a track in there that it rides on, and it had come off of that. There's the front panel controls here. There's an infrared, I believe that's both a transmitter and a receiver. Two volume controls, power LED, and a front panel mounted connection for the headphones. This hole here that looks like it would have a speaker in it is actually, it's actually not a speaker. I think it could have been or was planned to be. This machine, like every other Macintosh ever made, does have a built-in speaker. When it's used without any external speakers plugged in, this is a full-range speaker. When you plug in any kind of additional speaker, like these over here, and I've never seen a set of those before, but when you plug in any kind of additional speaker, the output of the internal speaker is low-pass filtered, so low frequencies are allowed to continue on through, which turns it into kind of a subwoofer, although it's not much of a subwoofer because I think it's like a 3.5-inch driver in a plastic enclosure. But Apple did try to make it perform as a sort of pseudo-subwoofer. Go ahead and put the front panel back on here. It just pivots into place. And there's another look at the machine. Now, as for these Apple speakers, I'd never seen anything like these before. They're very interesting. These are actually pretty nice speakers. And Apple actually had... They must have been planning to do a pretty good job with these, because not only will they play fairly impressively loud, but they actually sound pretty good. I think they're a little lacking in the high end. They only have a single... I'd call that a 3-inch driver in there. Filter caps seem to be good. These things have been riding around in my truck for about the past 3 weeks, and when I hit the power button without having them plugged into the power brick, the power light actually flashed for a moment and then went out as the capacitors discharged. So I guess they used some pretty good caps in them. Yeah, they don't sound bad, and Apple actually intended for you to use these as almost a kind of stereo speaker, because they have RCA phono jack style inputs on the back. For they're marked for a CD player, but they would happily accept any line level input or the output of a phono preamplifier or anything like that. So I guess they thought that, you know, users might hook these up to some sort of a stereo component, probably a CD player, and actually play the output through there. Now, the little monitor, and you can see the horrible mess that is my computer room, so don't make too many derogatory comments about that, because I do need to clean it up badly, and I am presently working on that. It's just kind of turned into an amazing dump party in here, but I digress. The little monitor is a 13, it's a 12-inch. It's a 12-inch monitor is what it was sold as. Has a 640 by 480 resolution, and uses a Trinitron picture tube, and this monitor is still in great shape. Now, as with other Macintoshes, this thing does support soft power on and soft power off. The monitor actually plugs into the back of the power supply on the computer using that rarely seen, today anyway, and even more rarely used, inverted IEC-style power connection that used to be on the back of a lot of PC power supplies. Anyway, a relay in the power supply actually turns power on and off to that second IEC socket, so as long as the monitor's power button is pushed in, when you turn the computer power on, the monitor will come along with it. Of course, I got the original keyboard and mouse. This machine is in pretty good condition. It's got some scuffs and scrapes. There's a couple of things up here. There's a mark or two on the monitor, and of course, there's a lot of hand salsa and other grime on the keyboard. I had to clean the mouse a little bit, but that was nothing I couldn't do. It still works quite well, although being a ball-style mouse, the top of this table is a little too slick for it, so I had to go steal the mouse pad off of my Dell Dimension 8300 from across the room. Talk about the stuff that came with the computer. These are the original recovery discs. Move the keyboard out of the way here, and I can show you these. There is the Macintosh Performa Guided Tour, 3D Atlas, ABC... World Reference. I don't imagine that ABC does that anymore. The Macintosh Performa 6400 series, Performa Software. This is the system installation CD. Descent, probably a kind of game, never heard of it. Thinkin' Things 2. I like the sound of that, from Edmark Software, which I believe later became a division of IBM, or maybe was a division of IBM from the start. Adobe Photo Deluxe. Now, Touch Base and Datebook Pro CD. It's probably a better Now CD than any of those, now that's what I call music CDs, because I certainly don't call most of those music. The Amazing Writing Machine from Broderbund Software. Same people that brought you Where in the World is Carmen Sandiego. Mayo Family Health. They're probably rather dated at this point. It's the 1996 edition. American Heritage Children's Dictionary, Macintosh edition, published by Dorling Kindersley. Same people who make those, I forget what they call them, but they're almost like a little museum in a book. Libraries have them. Our Times, Multimedia Encyclopedia of the 20th Century, from Vicarious Software. There was a PC version of that, too. Club Kidsoft, Movies and Videos from Blockbuster Entertainment. I might want to take a look at that. That might be really interesting. And then, of course, the ubiquitous Quicken, and the growlier Multimedia Encyclopedia from 1996. I had the PC version of that back in the day. Had that back in 1994. It was a pretty cool little program to play with. As well as, so was the Compton's New Media Encyclopedia for computers as well. Remember that in all its double-speed glory on the Panasonic CD-ROM drive on a Dell Precision 433SI. Those were the days. Other compact discs. Educator Advantage CD-ROM Collection. This guy's wife, she was a teacher. I think she still is a teacher, to tell you the truth. And that's probably what this is doing in here. Maybe she bought the machine, for all I know. The San Diego Zoo presents the animals. World Atlas from the Software Tool Works. Again, I used the PC version of these things back in the day. A lot of fun back then. It was a different time, I'll tell you that. Now here we have two packets, and the two packets here, they kind of have me worried. This one says play. I like the sound of that, but check this out. Here's another packet that says work. Now you see the problem here? I'll try to show you. Check out the thickness of the work packet as compared to the play packet. They don't look a whole lot different to the camera, I don't think, but the work one is much heavier than the other, and I'll tell you what, folks, that's just not right. Here is the Macintosh Performa User's Manual. It includes setup, troubleshooting, and health-related information for Macintosh Performa 6400 series computers. And we're supposed to read this book first. I like the big SCSI symbol that's on there. That's very nice. Netscape Quick Tour for Macintosh, accessing and navigating the Internet's World Wide Web, which is actually the correct way to say it. As you can see, some of these books are a little dusty. I haven't cleaned much of this stuff up yet. Here's the machine's built-in modem and communications package from Global Village Communication. There probably aren't a whole lot of these left. This is the welcome mat that Apple would have provided to every purchaser of a Macintosh Performa back in the day. And it says, if you are new to the Macintosh, listen to the instructions. So if you ever wondered, you know, I bought a computer, now what? Well, this would purport to tell you. A host on screen will guide you through your first moments with your Macintosh. There always was something cool about the classic Mac OS, just that elegant simplicity. I liked it. I was a PC guy growing up, started out on an Apple II Plus, and then my grandmother moved and decided to leave her K-Pro computer to me, her K-Pro professional computer, which was an IBM clone. And then I graduated to a Packard Bell 386SX, and then to a Dell Precision 433SI that I really wish I still had today. Because I've gotten the K-Pro again, and I've got a similar Packard Bell, but I haven't been able to find the Dell. Getting back on the subject, here are the Apple Design powered speakers. Congratulations, you've made a sound investment. I wish I had an instant rim shot right about now. ClarisWorks. You can see that one needs a good dusting. No, those aren't mold spots. They're just dust. This stuff was just buried in his computer desk. Been there probably since the computer was new. Packing list for Macintosh Performa 6400 series personal computer with CD-ROM drive. Here's what you would have gotten when it was brand new. A Macintosh Performa 6400 series personal computer with integrated CD-ROM. One keyboard, one desktop bus mouse 2, a plain talk microphone that I don't think I got, but I have a world of those things. Telephone modem cable, power cord, CD-ROM discs, two manuals, booklet, an Apple resource guide, product registration card, and a partridge in a pear tree. The machine had an HP DeskWriter 600 series printer with it. That is actually sitting upstairs waiting to come down here right now because I don't really have a good place to put it. Back in the day when I got my DeskJet 660 CSE, I remember this little booklet, how best to create colorful documents with your new HP printer. And in what may be a more troubling sign, learn is bigger than work and play combined. there's a bunch of neat stuff in here somewhere. Somewhere along the way in all this documentation, I actually found the product registration card completely filled out, but seemingly never mailed in. Guide to Apple Customer Services. User's Guide for the HP DeskWriter 660C printer. And a DeskWriter was nothing more than a DeskJet with the Macintosh serial communications bus on it, as opposed to the PC parallel port. There's the book for the Macintosh color display. User's guide. There's the air conditioning coming on. Now these are cool. I know that Apple includes these with modern products. I did not know they were including these stickers with stuff back in the day. And I like this logo a lot better anyway. It's a lot prettier to me for some reason. You know, if I wouldn't feel bad about taking these off the sheet, I might stick them to something, but I can't bring myself to do that. I haven't got the heart to take those off there after this many years. Apple Internet Connection Kit. Your new Apple support card. Ah, there's the registration card right there. Like I say, I think that's got personal information on it. Using your modem. Doesn't say anything on the back of it. Well, that's pretty much all the documentation. Let's go ahead and power this thing up. I'm sure you're just dying for that. And oh yeah, a CD caddy. I have no idea where this thing came from or even what it was intended for use with, because this machine certainly does not take CD caddies. And as far as I know, this was their first computer ever. Let's go ahead and turn this thing on. Loud enough for you? That brings back fond memories. I had a Power Macintosh 6500. It was also sold as the Performa 6500, if my recollection is correct. And I would sit down here and I would power that thing on, and my brother, College 153, when he was still at home, he would refer to that as whomping the Macintosh, because it made just a dull, bassy thump in his bedroom, and that was all he could hear. And in a rather more juvenile sense, we used to spend a lot of time sitting down here on Mac OS 9 typing swear words into the system and having Macintosh Pro English read them back to us. Like I say, it was a juvenile pursuit, but we were a lot younger back then, so I hope it can be forgiven. Besides, who wouldn't make a computer swear given the chance? Here it is powering up. I'll probably turn this down a little bit so I don't serenade myself right out of the room. The Finder starts up, then the launcher comes up. This is Mac OS 7.5. Then you get the desktop icons. And then a cute little welcome screen comes up. I suppose that was probably intended to be turned off, but the guy who owned this wasn't very much into computers and he didn't have a lot of technical expertise, so he pretty much left it alone. Now, this is the machine running as it was found. The time and date are correct on it. It's still keeping pretty good time. It drifts by a couple minutes if it's unplugged for a long time, so I suspect that the battery is probably getting ready to fail in it, but it hasn't actually gone yet. Anyway, the hard disk on this thing probably ought to be wiped. You know, if for no other reason than that person's security, and so I'll have to do that at some point. Obviously, I haven't done it yet, but I'll have to. I've got the restoration disc, so it should be no problem to put everything back. But everything's pretty much as he left it back then. And of course, you know, here's the software that would have come with the machine, ClarisWorks, which was actually a very capable piece of software. You could think of it as an equivalent to Microsoft Works, if that's what you're more familiar with. But it did a lot more. It could do your word processing, your spreadsheeting, database, and of course bulletin board system communications. But it also had the ability to do not only drawing, but also painting. That's right, it has both kinds. Or to paraphrase the Blues Brothers movie, they play both kinds of music here, country and western. So there's the old ClarisWorks program. Other than that, there's not a whole lot to say about this thing. It's got an early copy of Adobe Reader on it. America Online. Boy, that used to be everywhere. It used to be a household word. How times have changed. There's Adobe Photo Deluxe. Let's just go ahead and see what version the Adobe Reader is on this system. Oh, wow. 2.1. Wow. Copyright 1995. Doesn't seem like it's been that long ago. A little bit of credits to the developers. They still put that in current versions of Adobe Reader. I guess a person ought to compare it and see how many names are still on the list all these years later that match between the two versions. There's the American Heritage Dictionary over there. Of course, there's a lot more applications in the actual applications folder. All kinds of neat stuff in there. I love the icon on that Netscape folder. But that's a quick look at the machine. Let's go ahead and revisit the audio. I've actually got a music CD over here. I'll give you a little demonstration of what this thing's audio system sounds like. But it should serve as a rough guide. There's the audio CD player with a CD inserted. Now, I brought up the monitors and sound control panel here, not so much to show off anything the monitor could do, although you can see it's running in thousands of colors, or the high color mode, but to show you a feature that this thing has that I think is done basically entirely in software, because in later versions of the Mac OS, I'm pretty sure that this feature disappeared. This 3D surround sound function, which actually plays games with the audio as it comes out of the computer to make it sound like you have more speakers than you really do. Sometimes it works well, sometimes it doesn't, but I'm going to give you a demonstration right after I play a little bit of an excerpt from this CD and demonstrate how the speakers sound, as well as approximately how loud they'll get, even though it's fairly early in the morning. That's basically wide open right there. Now, as far as the 3D surround sound effect goes, let me get another track queued up and I'll show that to you. I can actually turn this on and off at will, so I'll go ahead and put another song on here. And hopefully you can notice the difference when I turn it on. So there you pretty much have it. Go ahead and close these control panels here. Eject the CD from the drive. Yep, there it is. Put the drive back in. Go ahead and quit the CD player. And then shutting this thing down, Apple doesn't make that very hard at all. All I have to do is pull down the special menu, choose shut down, and then the computer goes to sleep with a click. Shuts off, actually. So there you have it. Thank you for watching, and feel free to leave a comment below.